Hi, welcome to the Wool Needles Hands podcast. My name is Taylor, and this is a podcast about knitting and crafting and making here in Las Vegas, Nevada, where I live and where I'm from. I live here with my husband, my son Angus, who's 2, and our fat, lazy cat, Oscar. Okay, so episode 2. This is a really big deal for me. I'm so excited to be on my second episode. I had so much fun filming the first one, and I had fun filming the vlog in between the first and this episode, and I'm super excited that I'm doing this, and I've gotten some really cool positive feedback from people who have watched, and it's heartwarming. I can't think of another way that's less cheesy to explain it, but it's heartwarming and I appreciate it. So thank you. So thank you for coming back. So you can find me on social media. On Instagram, I am at Wool Needles Hands, and on Ravelry, I am Wool Needles Hands as well. I have a blog, which is woolneedleshands.blog. You can check me out there. I blog about the latest things I'm working on, some projects that I have upcoming. I talk a little bit about my goals. Sometimes I just blog about things that are on my mind that are related to crafting and making and knitting. So check that out if you haven't done that. I've also created a Ravelry group for the podcast, which is brand new, so there's not a whole lot going on right now, but if you're watching the podcast and you like it, not only like and subscribe here, but go check out the Ravelry group, introduce yourself so I can kind of get to know some of the people that are watching the podcast. The Ravelry group is under the name Wool Needles Hands, so check that out when you get a chance. I'll post updates and show notes there, as well as at my blog. I have a lot to talk to you guys about today, and my show notes are pretty extensive, so I'm going to do my best to kind of keep it as organized as I can. I might break off into chit-chat about something. I've had a lot of things kind of running through my mind, like ideas that I'd love to share with you guys. I may get to them in this episode. I may not. I may save them for the next episode, but we'll see. We'll see how it goes. First things first, what am I drinking this time around? In my little blue Moroccan style mug, I have, it's a really delicious tea. Oh, smells so good. It's by a brand, I don't know how to pronounce it. I think I want to say it's Puka. You can tell me, I'm not really sure, but I just picked this up at Sprouts. It's delicious. It's peppermint and licorice. And it's kind of unique. It's uniquely refreshing. And I love this box. I mean, look how cute this box is. I love that. So yeah, that's what I'm drinking right now. And it's good. I like it. So if you're into peppermint and licorice, check it out. In knitting news, I was kind of looking on the interwebs, trying to find some interesting stories to share with you guys, because nothing just popped up organically between my last episode and now, so I thought, hey, I'm gonna go hunting out some cool fiber news, or knitting news, or yarn news, I don't know. Apparently, there is a particular, I mean, I guess you could call them street artists, but a particular street artist who, kind of uses yarn bombing as her form of art. Her name is London Kay, and she is kind of taking the whole yarn bombing thing to a new level. Like her displays are really intricate, and they're big in a lot of cases. Sometimes they're small, but they're really creative. And I'm not sure if you're familiar. A few years ago, I saw a documentary about a street artist by the name of Banksy. So he's like pretty well known in that community. He was kind of like elusive, like nobody really knew where he was or ever saw like a picture of his face. I don't know if that's true anymore, but I did watch this documentary, and the stuff that he did was like really outrageous, sometimes crazy over the top with not just spray paint. I mean, it's not even just spray paint, it's like structural street art using actual, like I think he used like a phone booth in the UK at some point. He used like a phone booth to create some kind of structural street art when I was watching this documentary. They were talking about that. And so when I read this article, I was like, her work kind of reminds me of that kind of street art in that it uses things that already exist in an urban setting and adds to it to create an image. So she has one particular display where there's a, it's a pipe coming up out of the sidewalk on a street, and coming out of the pipe is this mass of crochet fabric, and it looks just like a liquid coming out of this pipe, and it spreads all over the sidewalk, and it's in crochet in various different colors, and it's really pretty incredible. I'll post some pictures, I'll patch in some pictures here. But she does some pretty cool stuff that, I mean, some would call it graffiti, but it's so artistic and so soft and not aggressive that you can't help but think that it's like decorative. So I don't know, it's really interesting. It says in the article that her work ranges from whimsical to subversive. So I guess you could say it does kind of edge on that subversive style, but the pictures that I'm seeing, definitely whimsy comes to mind. So I don't know, check it out if you have a chance. Go online, look up London K, see some of the stuff that she's doing. It's really pretty impressive. It's cool too, because apparently she's caught the attention of some corporate, you know, like big businesses, big companies, Starbucks, the Miller Beer Company has contacted her about doing installments for them. So, I mean, it's no small thing. So I thought it was kind of interesting. So yeah, check it out. I thought it was a pretty cool story. Okay, so I want to talk to you guys a little bit about some of the cals that I'm going to get involved in. I'm super excited. As you know, I'm already doing the Box of Socks cal. If you watched the last episode, I'm getting into the Box of Socks cal because one of my goals for 2017 was to participate in at least two cals. And I think that the way that I'm going right now, I'm going to nail that goal because I already have Box of Socks going. I'm in the works with that. I'm super motivated about that. And then I'm also participating in the Find Your Fade Cal, which we'll talk about that when we get to Works in Progress. But I have a couple others that I want to participate that are upcoming. So I wanted to share some of those with you just to give you guys a heads up if you're interested, and see if it would be something that you guys would be interested in. So the first one that's coming up that I want to participate in is Candace at Pin Feathers and Pearls. She's doing a stripey socks cal, and I believe it kicks off on the 14th of February, and I think it goes for a month, and you can knit a pair of socks using self-striping yarn, or you can create a stripe pattern yourself in the socks. But she specified pretty clearly in her podcast episode that it's not something where you use a variegated yarn that kind of looks stripey. It has to be purposefully striped. So you have self-striping yarn, or you're actually making the stripes yourself. And I have a really cool yarn that I wanted to use for that. It's actually right up here in my stash. So I showed this in my last episode. It is Rock and String Creations. It's a sock set. It's called the Matchy Matchy Sock Set in Seaside Treasure. So you can see, let's see if it, yeah. There we go. Yeah, it's gorgeous. So this is a self-striping yarn that I'm gonna use for that particular cal, and I'm super excited about that. And it's great because I can double dip and use it for my Box of Socks cal as well. The other cal that I'm excited about is the Harry Potter cal that Katie from the Inside Number 23 podcast is hosting. It's a year-long cal. You can knit anything inspired by Harry Potter, or you could, it just, you're doing something. I might be wrong. If I'm wrong, correct me in the comments, but you're doing something knitting related or fiber related that is inspired by Harry Potter. And so I thought that was a cool idea. I love Harry Potter. I thought that I would knit a pair of socks that I could use to double dip for the Box of Socks for that one as well. But I changed my mind because I haven't knit a hat in quite a while. And I found a pattern for a hat called the Parcel Tongue Hat. It's really beautiful. The cabling is really pretty, and I was thinking to take it a step further, since I've been playing around with hand dyeing yarn, that I would maybe watch some of the Harry Potter movies, get inspired by the colors that I see, and come up with a colorway that I could dye up just for that particular hat. So I'm excited about that. But yeah, it's a year-long knit along, so you can kind of, I think you can just kind of pop in at any time you have to go on and look at the details on Katie's Ravelry group for this particular cowl, but it sounds like a lot of fun. So that's the Stripey Socks cowl, the Harry Potter cowl, the Box of Socks cowl, and the Find Your Fade cowl. So I'm at four right now. I'm at four cows right now that I'm getting involved in, and some of those are like double dipping, so I'm killing two birds with one stone, I guess you could say, but I'm super excited about that. So I just wanted to let you know. I'm sure you've heard of these already if you're watching any of these podcasts, but I'm on board, so if you haven't decided to join and maybe you're kind of interested, check out the Ravelry page and join. It's fun. Okay. So let's move on to works in progress. I have to be completely honest. I know that in my last episode I mentioned that I'm only going to be showing works in progress from 2017. And that's true. I really only want to focus on those, but I was going through a basket that I have that contains I think about four or five works in progress that are definitely from before 2017. And I'm not going to show them to you this episode, but I think next episode, because the things I'm working on right now, I'm trying not to cast on anything new outside of those cows that I talked about. So the works in progress that I have right now are going to be with me for a little bit until I finish my socks, but I'll have more socks. And so I'm going to kind of focus on those this episode. But next episode, I want to show you guys some of the works in progress that I have from previous projects before 2017, because there's some in this basket that I'm really excited to kind of revisit. Look for that in the next episode. But right now I'm just going to kind of show you some of the things that I'm working on for the cowls that are going on at the moment. Okay, so the first work in progress that I have is the Find Your Fade shawl. Like I said, I'm participating in the knit along for Find Your Fade, and I'm in love with the finished product. I've seen other people's shawls completed and I think they're gorgeous. I can't wait to have one of my own, especially because of how big they are and cozy they are. They're just so luxurious looking, so I'm super excited about it. But I gotta be honest with you guys, this pattern has got my number, because for whatever reason, and I haven't gotten very far, so I'll just show you, and I need to put something behind it because the yarn is pretty dark, but all I have is the little thong. That's it. Everybody says they look like a thong, and I agreed that they do look like a thong when I watch some other podcasts, but when I knit up this little piece, actually it was the first thing that my husband said. He's like, are you knitting a G-string? I'm like, yeah, of course I'm knitting a G-string. What else would I be doing? That's all I have, and it's because I've made it into the lace section. I've made it maybe four or five rows into the lace section, and then something happens. I don't know what happens, but my stitch count goes off, and I swear I'm doing everything right, and then all of a sudden I count my stitches and something's amiss, and it drives me crazy because I don't know how to really go back and remedy that, because the lace, I'm not really confident in lace knitting. It's not something I do a lot, so I didn't really know how to even go back and find my mistake, so I would just frog it and then start over. And I've done this three times. This is my third time. I haven't made it to the lace section yet. I'm really close. So I'm just keeping my fingers crossed. My husband and I just recently started watching the series Firefly on Netflix. And so I don't know why I've chosen to make that the time that I work on this, but lesson learned, not the right time, because I, for whatever reason, even though I'm not, like, even though my eyes aren't on the screen, I'm focusing on what I'm knitting. It's like something happens and I lose my count. So I'm gonna have to do this in isolation. I don't know. If you're having issues with this, let me know so I know I'm not the only person. But there's just something about, and here, I'll ask a question. So if you're watching and you're doing a Find Your Fade and you know the answer to this question, then tell me. But am I right when you knit to the double decrease in the middle? So you knit to two before the marker, you slip one, and then you have to kind of slip the second one, pull the marker off, slip the one behind the marker, knit those two together, pass the first slip stitch over, and then put the marker. Do you put the marker on the left side of that decreased stitch, of the decreased stitch, or do you put it on the right side of the decreased stitch? I'm pretty sure you put it on the left side, and then you keep moving, like you replace it. If this makes any sense, if you have any idea what I'm asking, then you can leave something in the comment section. I think I'm okay. I think I have it figured out. But it was just, I was just wondering, because I do know, I did read the directions, that there's half plus one on, if you're looking at the right side, there's half plus one to the right of the stitch marker, and then there's half to the left of the stitch marker. I don't know. I really want to get moving on this, because I do love the pattern. So I think it's definitely operator error, but that's that. And, you know, the reason why I started, obviously, is because my yarn came in the mail. I mentioned this in the last episode, that I hadn't started my fade and that I was kind of late because I hadn't gotten the yarn yet, but I did get the yarn. And if you happen to watch my vlog, the Making Progress vlog, I showed the yarn that I got in the mail. So I'm just going to show you really quick what I have. It's in this giant basket right here. So let's see, let's go through what we have here. I'm starting out with this. There you go. And from there, I think I'm going to move to this. There we go. So I'm going to move to this. And from there, I'm going to this. And I'm thinking after that, I'm not 100% sure. And then from there, I'm not really clear on what I'm going to do next. But I have this amazing color, this amazing color, and this one. It's losing its twist a little bit. These are all from Lichen and Lace. They're beautiful. I'm in love with the colors. I only kind of know what my first three colors are going to be, and then I haven't really figured it out, but I'll just figure it out as I go. Who knows? So that's my Find Your Fade. This over here. Yeah, so if you have any advice on the Find Your Fade, or maybe you just want to tell me some issues that you had, so I know what other kind of issues I can anticipate in my future, let me know. I did download and print out the updated pattern. They sent that to everybody that was participating in the CAL. So that should be helpful in the future, but like I said, I think it's just me. Who knows? Okay, so my next work in progress is really, it's kind of like a hoe and a half. Is that even like a thing? Can that be a thing? So I have, for my box of socks, it's just a plain vanilla sock in the Barocco Ultra Alpaca. It's blue spruce. The way the camera shows it here, it's kind of like blown out a little bit. It's a little bit less blue than this. But so I have this, and this is the progress I've made on my second. And I'm pretty pleased with that, considering all the other things I've been working on. So I'm not doing too bad. So that's what I have going on there. I actually started playing around with the whole, so my tension's not always on the money. For whatever reason, up until extremely recently, because I was playing around with a different way of throwing my yarn, my tension kind of wavers. So I'll be fine for several stitches, and then I'll just feel it's like the yarn just falls out of my hand. I don't know what it is. And it was frustrating me because it would cause me to have to stop and recoil my yarn and move on, and it just slows me down. And it's not because I want to be this super fast knitter. I enjoy the process of knitting. I enjoy the time it takes me to knit something, but I don't like it when it's unnecessarily slow because I'm fumbling with my yarn. And so I was trying to play around with a different way that I can do this. And I know that if you're familiar with Mina of the Knitting Expat podcast, she flicks when she knits, which is like watching her, it's mesmerizing. She's so fast. Like her fingers just move like so fast. So she can knit. I think somebody was mentioning in another podcast that she can knit a pair of socks in like a day because she knits two at a time. I don't know, but it's something crazy. And I don't expect myself to ever be that fast, just because I know that it would take me a lot of frustrating hours of practice to become that fast, and I don't think I'm willing to do that. But I was playing around with the whole like flicking method, and so I've been practicing that with this, and I'm actually pretty happy with the way it's working out. It seems to work for me. It keeps my tension pretty consistent. I'll take a clip of me doing what I'm talking about and I'll patch it in here so you can kind of get an idea of this method that I came up with. And it's not, I mean, I didn't come up with it. It's something that I've seen other people do. It's just like a, hybrid of various different styles. But yeah, so you can kind of see what I'm doing there. Share with me what techniques you use, because I've tried continental knitting and it's okay. I didn't learn to knit that way, so I think it's always going to be kind of challenging to knit with my left hand. But yeah, I'd like to know if anybody has some magic technique for kind of getting a good clip when you're knitting. But okay, so moving on. So that was my second work in progress. It's just a plain vanilla sock. Until my Find Your Fade shawl really gets going, I feel like nothing that I'm working on right now is super exciting. I mean, I don't want to downplay it. I like what I'm knitting, but okay, whatever. This is my improvised top-down raglan sweater, and I just added a neckline to it. Okay, so I'm going to hold this up, and I'm going to see if I can get this to show. Oh gosh, it's so hard with the lighting here. But if you can see basically how I'm showing you right now, I've added a rolled collar, and it's really cute. It kind of stands up, gives it a little bit of a funnel shape almost. I really like it, and it was super easy to add. So yeah, it's just my rolled collar, and I haven't done any sleeves yet, and I'm still not quite finished with the length. I really like this because it's so fast. However, because I've been knitting so many things, so many socks, or not so many socks, but because I've been knitting socks and using finer yarns, I kind of find these super bulky yarns to be just clunky and cumbersome. So it's an interesting contrast going back and forth between the two types of projects. But no, I really like this. And what I like about it the most is that, like the vanilla socks, it doesn't really follow a pattern. I'm using Karen Templer's How to Improvise the Top-Down Raglan series that she posted on her blog, and it's similar to Kate Atherley's Socks 101 in that all she does is she provides you with how to take your measurements and turn it into a sweater pattern using, you know, different proportions and percentages and things like that. There's definitely lots of Elizabeth Zimmerman influences in this series, but I mean, of course, because she's the guru of constructing sweaters. But it's a really, really great series to check out if you're interested in creating your own sweater, and maybe take a basic sweater pattern and design, you know, a more custom design or look to it. But yeah, I kept a notebook while I did this. I highly recommend doing that. It would be really difficult to create your sweater if you didn't keep notes of your measurements and your stitch count and things like that. I just got a basic graph paper notebook and took all of my notes in there. This, let's see. Yeah, so I just kept track of my, you know, my stitch count. Based on my gauge, I did some sketches to kind of show, let's see if it focuses, what it was I was going for. Did all of my math in certain sections, but this particular sweater, I mean, I say it's easy, and it is easy, but I guess I'm not really making it seem easy with all of the notes, but I just took several pages of notes as I went along doing this. So I recommend doing that if you are going to follow the series, just to have the notes to go back on if you wanted to recreate your pattern. So yeah, so there's that. I'm going to focus on getting this finished as soon as I can, because I have lots of other things coming up that I want to do, and this, I know that even by the time I finish it, it'll probably be too warm outside to wear it, so it'll be ready for me for next season. All right, so my third work in progress of 2017, to be specific. So I was gonna knit these for my husband, Brandon, for Valentine's Day, and I still probably might finish them in that time, I'm not sure, but when you see them, you'll wonder if I'll have enough time to finish them. But I had a couple skeins of Croy self-striping yarn, and since I've purchased this and decided to cast on with this, I've seen a few other knitters on Instagram posting pictures with this yarn of socks that are finished or pretty much finished, and it looks great. Like, I'm really excited to get socks going with this because it's a great looking yarn. I'm knitting these two at a time. And this is what, I don't know if it's the way I wound the balls up, but they're definitely not gonna match. They're gonna be brothers, but definitely not twins. So this is all I have at this point. There we go. Yep, so that's all I've got. So they're not looking the same, probably because of me, but each sock will have stripes, I can tell you that. But yeah, I'm knitting these two at a time. These are on size 3 Addy Click, or not Addy Clicks, Addy Turbos, which I'm still deciding if these are the needles for me. I'm not exactly sure, but I mean, I love their super flexible cable. That's definitely, you know, a good thing. But I haven't decided if I like the needles as much as the high sharps. I have a pair of Chiagus coming in the mail to transfer my Find Your Fade shawl onto, because I'm using Addy Lace Turbos for my Find Your Fade. And going back to that for just a minute, I actually bought these needles to replace the Knit Picks needles I was using for this originally, because those were driving me crazy. The joins on my Knit Picks interchangeables just catch all the time and make me a crazy person. So I ordered a pair of Addy Lace Turbos for that. And so this is what they look like. Let's see if you can see. Might be easier to see against my shirt. Now, the points on these aren't really that pointy. They kind of have a good rounded tip to them, and for the lace work that I'm doing on the Find Your Fade, I almost want something significantly more pointy, and that's why I decided to give the Chiagus a try, because somebody was mentioning to me that those would be a good way to go, because they also have a really flexible cable. She sent me a really helpful comment about some needles that she's familiar with, and she mentioned Chiagus, and so it kind of made me feel good about the purchase that I made to get those for this particular pattern. So I'm excited to get those, because these Addy Lace Turbos are just not, I don't understand. I mean, I feel like my Knit Picks were sharper than these, so whatever. needles. Okay, so that was my third work in progress, these little stripey socks from a mister. They just look like little mustaches right now. Like a giant mustache. It's like a Fu Manchu. This is a sock Fu Manchu. Okay. Actually have an FO for you guys today, so I'm gonna call this my faux show. I am super excited about this, and I have to apologize because I feel like my sock blockers are too small, or I've stretched my socks a little bit because I've worn them a few times, but they're kind of wrinkly and ripply on my sock blockers, but I don't care, they're amazing. It's just a vanilla sock using Long Dog yarn. It's in the Dark Dimension and Quick Fling colorways. So we have Quick Fling is my heels, cuffs, and toes, and Dark Dimension is the rest of the body of the sock. I'm super excited about these. They're so cozy, so comfortable. I've worn them a few times, and I'm really happy with my picked up stitches. It's nice and clean. Yeah, my green ones, the green vanilla socks that I am knitting right now, the first one that I'm knitting, the picked up stitches were a hot mess, but I'm really happy with the way these came out. Yeah. And they fit really well too. This is the first pair of hand knit socks that I've made, and they fit really well. Like, I'm tempted to, you know what I'm gonna do? You just watch, this is gonna be great. Okay, are you ready for this? Yep. Yeah. That is a great fit, ladies and gentlemen. Look at the heel. I'm not really that flexible. I think I'm going to pay for that later. Yeah, so that's my finished object, and I'm super excited about it. I wanted to tell you guys a little bit about... Everybody talks about their recipe for vanilla socks, and I think it's cool. It's neat that everybody kind of has their own way of doing the same thing, ultimately. I mean, of course, it's not the same. Everybody has their own unique vanilla sock, but it's just neat that you come up with, like, your own recipe. It's like meatloaf. Vanilla socks are like meatloaf. Everybody has their own way of making it, and everybody's is better than everybody else's, and that's the way it's supposed to be. But anyway, I didn't really make up my own sock pattern or my sock recipe. I found by Kate Atherley, and I can't remember if I mentioned this in the last episode, but on Knitty, she has a socks 101 tutorial, and it's not a pattern. What she does is she kind of just gives you, she uses like this little mini, I don't know if you can see that, it's like a baby sock almost, and she kind of has you construct a little mini sock using the construction, like the math behind the construction of a sock. And so it's all about percentages and your measurements, and that's it. So there is no like pattern to this. You just kind of take the measurements for your foot and you calculate percentages after you know what your gauge is, and you have a vanilla sock that you can adjust based on what you're trying to do. So if you're interested, check it out. It's on Knitty, and it's by Kate Atherley, and it's called Socks 101. It's really simple, super simple, and she even leaves some notes after she gives you the plain vanilla sock tutorial. She talks about adding different kinds of yarn, adding different textures. It's just a real good blow by blow on how to create a vanilla sock. So, and then you can tweak it, design it however you want. So if you're interested in coming up with a vanilla sock recipe of your own, check out Kate Atherley's Socks 101 on Knitty. That's how I came up with my vanilla socks, so. Okay, let's move on to acquisitions. If you watched my vlog, Making Progress, you'll know that I have lots of acquisitions related to yarn dyeing that I show in there, and I don't have those with me right now because they're downstairs in my garage slash dyeing studio. I think I'm just gonna call it a dyeing studio from now on, because it just sounds so much more glamorous. But anyway, those are downstairs, so I don't have those with me. So go check out my vlog if you're interested in that. But right now I'm gonna show you the things that are a little bit more accessible to me in this creative space. And that is just tons of yarn and one big project bag. So I'm gonna actually show you the project bag first, and we'll do the yarn after that. Now if you watched my first episode, you'll know that I'm really into the French supply. This is silly. Like, who in the knitting community is not into fringe? I think their stuff is amazing, and they have the best project bags. I have a field bag. That's what my Find Your Fade is in. I love this field bag. It's amazing. But just in time for my Vogue Knitting Live trip coming up in March, I have a Woolaloo bag. This thing is a beast, you guys. It is so big. I'm gonna stand back to show you. Look at this. Amazing. It's so big. It holds that giant sweater that I showed you, and it has a real nice box bottom, so it stays open. I can just knit with the giant balls of yarn in this, and it's a tote. It's just great, you guys. I love it. So yeah, I'm gonna make that my first acquisition for this episode. Second, let's see. Well, I showed you all of the lichen and lace that came from my Find Your Fade shawl. I have all of those, so I guess we could call those acquisitions. But my mom, who just recently visited some of my family up in Utah, she was in Logan, Utah, and there is a yarn store there called Knit Unique. And this place is so precious. The window displays are incredible. I have some pictures of the window displays. I'll patch those in here. It's so cute. If you're ever in that area, check out this place, because she's got a great yarn selection, and it's just a cute, quaint little shop. Some of the things that she brought home from there are this skein of Louisa Harding Petura. It's a superwash fine merino with bamboo. It's a fingering weight yarn. All of these amazing colors on a gray base. It kind of reminds me a little bit of the dark dimension that I was using for my sock. Well, I guess it's not as fluorescent. Let's see if I can get it to focus here. Yeah. Similar. Very beautiful, though. And the bamboo gives it like a nice luster. It's so soft and squishy. My mom brought this for me because she wants me to knit her a pair of socks, which I'm really excited to do, especially with this yarn, just because it's so beautiful. So there's that. And then she brought two skeins of Malabrigo Rios in this gorgeous, like, pumpkin color. Look at that. I can't wait to knit something up with this that I can wear in the fall. It's a nice worsted weight. I actually don't know. Yeah, it's just pure superwash merino. This is 100 grams, 200 yards. Yeah, it's gorgeous. So I have two skeins of that. And she knows that I'm getting into hand dyeing yarn, and so she picked up from the same place, and this is from Knotwonk Springs, Fred and Joe Knowlton, who are the owners of this particular farm. They sell quality wool for hand spinning and weaving, breeding stock and market lambs, roving and knitting yarns. And this is just a plain natural wool. I'll bring it back a little bit. It is, it's like a wheat color, but it's 100% wool. It's a 3-ply sport weight yarn. And I love it. It's got, because it's got like this wheat color, I think that when I dye it, it'll have like a real deep, the color will be a little bit more deep than just a plain, you know, ecru yarn. But I'm really excited about this. It's got that real good, like rustic, sturdy feeling to it that I love. So that's that. And it's from, it's from Knotwonk Springs up in Utah. I think it's up in that Utah region. Does it say? Yeah, Cornish. It comes from Cornish, Utah. Okay. So those are my acquisitions in the sense of, I guess I made it sound like I had way more, but it's because of all the Find Your Fade Shawl yarn that I picked up. Let's go back. In the last episode on my wish list, I talked about wanting a skein of yarns by My Dear Designs called Woodlands, and that's one of them that I picked up and is one of my acquisitions that I wanted to use for my Find Your Fade Shawl, and so this is it in person. This is Woodlands by My Dear Design. Oh, it's so beautiful. And I don't know this. If you notice, this cake is really pretty. I pulled a string out and then wound it back around. But other than that, this cake is so pretty because another thing that was on my wish list that I have now is a Swift. Okay, which leads me to a little topic of conversation. I don't know if you have a Swift or if you just use a chair or what, but for the longest time I was just using a chair or my husband would help me with his arms. But recently, for whatever reason, that stopped working for me and it became a complete disaster. And so I put on my birthday list that I wanted a Swift for my birthday, which is mid-April, which is a couple months away from now. And just the other day, I was winding up a skein of yarn for my Find Your Fade shawl, and it was just horrendous. What was happening to me was horrendous. The yarn would get caught on my chair. It wasn't coming off freely. It was just such a mess. I was going crazy. And to prove just how awful this was, I will show you. This is what happens. Do you see this? This is what happens to a skein of yarn when you don't have a Swift, is that you get it tangled and you have to cut the yarn in different places. And now I have three teeny tiny little balls of yarn, plus the one big ball of yarn that I managed to break out for my Find Your Fade. But this is what I have because I didn't have enough time to sit there and unravel the yarn, and I was frustrated, and I hate having to do this because of the, you know, all the ends that you have to weave in as you go. Fortunately, Find Your Fade doesn't use the entire skein of yarn for all the different sections, but still, it drives me crazy. So while that was happening, I went on Amazon right away. I ordered myself a swift from Stanwood Needlecraft, yeah. And it came the next day, and now I have a swift. And I wound my first skein of yarn on that swift yesterday, and it was just heaven. It makes this whirring sound as it's winding your yarn, and it's the most pleasant sound. It's the sound of a machine. It's not even a machine, but it's the sound of a thing that can just get the job done right. And that's what I needed. And I'm so, so happy that I have it now. If you don't have a swift and you struggle with winding balls of yarn, just get a swift. It's $50. It's, you know, kind of pricey for just dropping $50, but get it. It changes things drastically. And then that way you don't have a handful of fuzzy balls. Yeah, I said that. I'm adding this to the acquisition section this week, even though it's not really an acquisition in the sense that I didn't purchase this final product, but it is my own hand-dyed yarn, and I'm so excited to share this with you. Okay, now I'm participating in the hashtag Yarn Love Challenge right now, and one of the more recent days was mistakes, and it was cool to read all of the different things that people were talking about making mistakes in this craft, working with yarn, working with fiber, knitting, crocheting, what have you, because it makes you realize that some of those mistakes that we make really can turn out to be quite lovely. They almost go from being mistakes to design elements, and so I thought that was a cool kind of message to be around when I was hand dyeing yarn. And so these, I mean, they're far from perfect. I mean, what is perfect when it comes to hand dyeing yarn? It's just all, you know, it's an art, I guess. But I'm really happy with the way they came out. So, and again, if you want to get a better idea of the process that went into this, check out my vlog. I kind of go into way more detail about the process. Not a super amount of detail, but definitely more than what I'll show you here. I'll just show you the final product. But check that out if you're interested in my first experience at hand-dyeing yarn. But here are my final products. So this is the first one that I'm gonna show you. There we go. So the green is a spearmint green. I'm saying that only because that was the name of the particular dye that I used, and the what looks like purple, and it looks like purple in reality too, but is supposed to be a blush. So it was called Valentine Blush, but I believe mixing it with the green gave it much more of a purple color. But it's really pretty. It's interesting. It has like a cool tie-dye look to it. Yeah, so that's my first. And then this one is using much more of that Valentine blush. There's a little bit of the green in here too, so it's giving it that purple. But this is definitely more purple. There's a little bit of green in there that you can see. Yeah. So there's my second. And then a couple days later, I used up the rest of the green that I had, and I dyed up this skein, which is definitely far more vibrant and green. And I sprinkled it with jet black dye because I liked the idea of that, you know, emerald green with the contrast of black. If you check my Instagram feed, I kind of talk a little bit more about why I did that. I have a scarf. It's not a scarf, it's actually like a shawl that have these colors, and I love the way they look together. And so when I saw how the green was coming out, and the lighting right now is kind of washing out the color a little bit. If I back up, you can kind of see that it's definitely a more saturated green. But I don't know, I liked the contrast of the black and the green, and so I decided to sprinkle it with some black. But yeah, I'm really pleased with the way it came out. The yarns are super soft. It's just a sock base. It's a 7525 merino nylon, and yeah, I'm super happy with it. I'm excited to use it for some socks for my box of socks. This one, these two, I'm thinking about using in a sock body, heel, cuffs, and toes contrast. We'll see. I also was given some feedback, or somebody said on Instagram that I should make a shawl with this, which I thought would be fun too. Maybe like a color melting effect. I might wind these into, this might be 250 grams, and then kind of interplay with the color melting with those. But yeah, I'm super excited with how they came out for my first time. I mean, yeah, it's good. It's good. If you're interested in hand dyeing some yarn and you're nervous about it and you're not sure if it's for you, give it a shot, because it's definitely worth it. It's a lot of fun. I thought the process would be more intimidating than it actually was. It's kind of intimidating when you know that you have to wear a mask and eye protection and gloves, because it's dangerous to inhale the crystals of the acid dye. Like, it kind of spooks you a little bit because, you know, there's hazard involved. But, you know, I do that separately downstairs in my garage, and the only thing I did in my kitchen was with the liquid dye, so it was less hazardous in that particular sense. I followed all of the safety precautions, and once you know that that's taken care of, the creative process is really a lot of fun. And it's actually soothing. It's like, it's relaxing, it's mindful. And I'm really, this last week with the Yarn Love Challenge, talking about speed and mistakes and the various different things that people have been posting on Instagram in that vein, have really caused me to reflect on the mindfulness in this craft, and how taking the time to, you know, taking the time to absorb what it is that you're doing, and not trying to just get to the finished product so quickly, but just really living in the moment of the process. It's fun to think of it more like that, and it makes the whole process seem more meaningful. And so when I was doing the dyeing, you know, I was thinking I'm gonna worry less about what the finished product is gonna look like. I mean, I could go with like what I'm trying to achieve, but I'm just gonna take in the process, and I don't know, just kind of live in that creative moment. But I think if you approach it like that, it makes it fun, and it definitely makes you want to do it again. It's very addictive. I was warned on Instagram, along with lots of compliments on the yarn, like, welcome to yarn dyeing, like, prepare yourself, you're gonna be hooked. And yeah, it's so true. I'm already hooked. I'm already thinking about other like colors I'd like to play with. So yeah, I highly recommend it. If you're interested in giving it a shot, do it. Get yourself a starter kit, but definitely give it a try. Okay, in the way of project bags, I do have a couple more project bags that I want to show you, that are acquisitions, recent acquisitions. So the first one, it's really very appropriate right now because I'm knitting these socks two at a time. This is a project bag by Chica. I'll let you see the label. I'm not very familiar with what that is. I don't know if it's an Etsy shop, but it was gifted to me by my mom, and it's made out of just like it's got like a plastic coating on it here, so you can see that it's kind of shiny, and you can see through it has a window. But the greatest thing is it perfectly holds two balls of yarn, and it has two rings. Can you see that? Two rings in the top where you can thread your yarn through to keep your yarn kind of organized and from getting twisted when you're knitting socks two at a time. So I really like this. So if you happen to need a project bag that accommodates two at a time socks, check this out. I know though that there are a lot of really great project bags on Etsy that do accommodate two at a time sock knitting with the little holes that are reinforced for that. So check that out too. It's been a huge help with this. The second project bag that I intended to share with you in the last episode, but I completely forgot, a project bag that was gifted to me for Christmas by a really good friend. And I think it came from Cosplus World Market, but it is this. I think it's a cosmetics bag, but it's got this cute tassel, tons of space. My green vanilla socks are living in it right now, but it definitely has tons of space for a sock project or a hat project, something like that. But I really love this Aztec motif knit fabric that's on the front, woven fabric, I guess you would say. So yeah, those are some project bag acquisitions. Okay, so let's talk about this week's wish list. I only have three items on my wish list. That's crazy. It's a weekly thing, and I only have three. I think that's probably kind of excessive, but whatever. These are just things that I've seen on Pinterest, on Instagram, on the interwebs that I'm like, whoa. Love those. Maybe gotta have one of those. The first one is, I don't know if you've ever heard of this, but this little device is pretty incredible. It's called a Yarn Pet Duo, and I'll show a picture of it here. It holds your yarn on these two pegs, and then your yarn gets strung through the little coils, and you can knit with your two balls of yarn if you're doing color work, if you're knitting two socks at a time, but it just kind of keeps everything really organized. And so, thought I'd show that. I think that thing is amazing. I have a color work project from 2016 that I will show you in the next episode. But that particular item would be perfect because it keeps those balls of yarn in place. They don't bounce around. They don't get all twisted up. So I thought that was pretty awesome. I don't know if you've ever seen it before, but a Yarn Pet Duo. My second item on my wish list are from Steph Cuddles on Etsy, and they are these adorable little coffee cup stitch markers. I think these things are so precious. I mean, I've seen lots of coffee cup stitch markers, but there's something about how they're all multicolored that I love them so much. And I want to go on her shop and I want to just order a set because I would love to put them on my socks that I'm working on. They're just so cute. So yeah, that's by Steph Cuddles on Etsy. And my third item on my wish list, and I've seen these popping up lately, and they've probably existed for far longer than I've noticed them, but sock blanks. Like, okay. Before, just recently, I had never heard of a sock blank, and I see them all the time now, and people are knitting with them, and they are so cool. The concept is really, really awesome. So if you've never heard of a sock blank before, I'll show you what one looks like. I'll post a picture. But what they are is just a swatch of knitted fabric that has then been dyed in a design or in some kind of a color pattern, and you unravel it, wind the yarn into a ball that you can pull from, and then you knit with that particular yarn. And because the yarn was dyed knit, it kind of lends a more unique color, you know, a more cool, it's a cool color design that goes into your knitted project, because it's like you're taking one knitted project, taking it apart and reworking it into something else, and you're watching how the color develops in the new project. And I think it's such a cool concept. And there is one in particular that I'm really interested in, and it is by Amy of the Stranded Podcast. She has an Etsy shop called Stranded Dye Works, and her sock blank is called Street Art. And it's gorgeous. It's a really cool, like, tie-dye, like, color splatter piece, and it's just gorgeous. But that would be one that I have on my wish list. So yeah, if you haven't checked out Amy's Stranded Podcast, check it out, but also check out her Etsy shop, Stranded Dye Works. It's a really cool Etsy shop. She has lots of really great yarns. But yeah, her sock blanks are gorgeous. So that's something new that I didn't really know much about, but they exist, and I would like to knit with one. So that is my final item on my wish list. Okay, so I want to add a segment to my podcast, and I want to call this segment Food for Thought. It's just a place for me to share with you some ideas that I have, some fodder, I guess you could say, just fodder for thought, food for thought. there's a lot of chatter about two at a time sock knitting. You know, some people are trying it, some people are loving it, some people it's just not for them. So I kind of, in my mind, I came up with like a pros and cons for two at a time sock knitting. These were knit two at a time. So I'm using these as kind of my, you know, my, this is where I'm getting my source of, this is where my opinions are coming from, is this experience. These are the only socks I've knit two at a time. So my pros and cons come from this particular experience. So my first, my pros. When I knit two at a time, I know that my socks are going to match. And I think that little, you know, accessories like this, probably not so much socks because you wear them on your feet and they're not always showing, definitely more so mittens and gloves and things like that, but little accessories like this, it's really important, especially to the knitter, I think, that they match. Maybe not color scheme wise, but definitely fit and construction wise. And so knowing that you're going to be knitting the socks and they're going to match because you're knitting them at the same time, that's a huge weight off your shoulders. And that's my biggest pro for this particular method of sock knitting. And also it's really easy to kind of like, I knit mine from top down. And I can, I mean, I guess if you're knitting them toe up, you can do this too, but you can kind of try on one sock as you go and know that if that one sock works for you that way, the other sock is going to work for you that way. Unless, of course, you have two varying or differing sizes of feet, but you get what I'm saying, that you're knitting them the same way and that they end up looking the same. So that's a big pro. The second pro that I have is that you don't suffer from second sock syndrome. It was so cool casting off these socks and knowing that both of my socks were done. The cons is that it just takes a bit longer. And I think it takes, it doesn't take, well, I just think it seems to take longer because essentially you're knitting a bigger project. If you add two socks together in volume, it's something larger than just a single sock. So maybe you don't feel like you're getting anywhere as fast because you don't have that first sock to show as a part of your accomplishment. So yeah, it might seem like it takes a little bit longer. The second thing for my cons is that it's super fussy. You fuss with the cables, you kind of have to get everything, because you're doing essentially a magic loop. You have to kind of get everything situated. Turning the heel two at a time is not, you know, a walk in the park. It's totally doable, it's just kind of a pain. So yeah, it's definitely a little finicky, a little bit fussy. However, that being said, the pros and the cons for this particular style of sock knitting, my ultimate opinion about whether or not it's worth it to knit two at a time, absolutely, it's totally worth the cons. Not having second sock syndrome, having two socks that look identical in construction, totally outweighs the cons for me. It's a topic for conversation, so if you have anything to add, let me know. Okay, so the next item for food for thought that I wanted to mention is along the same lines of, I mean, I guess you could say it's a sock knitting issue. Actually, no, it's not even a sock knitting issue. It's an any knitting issue. But it's the question of to pattern or not to pattern. And I'll use my socks, just because I have them right here, as an example for this. I knit these using this really colorful variegated yarn, and the yarn kind of speaks for itself. It's beautiful, it has enough design wise to keep it interesting. And so the question is, in a sock like this with yarn like this, do I really want to take the time to knit up a heavily patterned sock, something with cables, something with lace? And I've been noticing lots of people posting gorgeous FOs of socks that are cabled or they have lace patterns, and they might even have like really fancy yarn color-wise. And it's just caused me to ask, like, do I want to do that? Do I want to knit, you know, a real fancy lace cabled sock if I'm using such, you know, standout yarn? And I don't know. I think for me personally, when it comes to socks, if I'm gonna knit something that's heavily patterned with lace or cables or some kind of a stitch pattern, then I'm going to forego a variegated yarn. So I don't know, that's kind of like a thought that's been rolling around in my mind, to pattern or not to pattern. So I'd like to know what you guys think about that. if you guys are knitting with really colorful speckled yarns, do you tend to shy away from heavily patterned socks or gloves or mittens or hats or what have you? Or are you all about it? Do you go right forward and do your patterned socks with the yarn and have the two meld together to make something beautiful? I'd like to know what you guys think about that. Okay, so those are the things that are kind of mulling around right now in my mind, some food for thought when it comes to knitty issues. So if you have anything you'd like to add to those topics, let me know, leave it in the comment section, start up a conversation. It's just, you know, it's just something that's been popping up, so I thought I'd talk a little bit about it. Okay, so Katie from Inside Number 23, in her, I want to say second to last podcast episode, she mentioned a segment that she's going to do, and she's calling it For the Love of Pod. And I thought it was cool. What it was kind of an opportunity for her to share some podcasts that she's been watching and loving with her viewers. And so I thought, I'm going to do that. I'm going to spread the word about some of them that I've been watching and really enjoying, that have been inspiring to me for whatever reason, so that you can then go and check them out if you haven't already checked them out, because I think it's just cool how in this knitting community everybody shares the goings-on of other people, because they serve as great inspiration for all of us. So I wanted to take a second just to share with you a couple of podcasts that I have been watching and really enjoying, so that you can go check them out. So the first one is the Little Tailoress podcast. And she does knitting and sewing, and she has an Etsy shop, and I think her Etsy shop is called The Little Tailoress. She makes project bags, and she just started to hand dye yarn, and she has some really beautiful colorways, and I love her inspiration for her colorways. So if you haven't checked out her podcast or her Etsy shop, do it. She has such a nice, calming aesthetic. I feel like when I watch, it's just the tones in her videos are so calming, and the way that she talks about various different things. I just really get a kick out of her show. It's very enjoyable to watch. So if you haven't checked out The Little Tailoress, please check it out. It's a good one. The second one is the Charm of It podcast, another one with very calming aesthetic, really easy to listen to. She talks about, you know, knitting. She'll show tutorials in her podcast episodes. So if you're looking for some new podcasts to watch, check those two out. They're great. I subscribed immediately when I started watching. And if you have your own podcast or just watch podcasts and are on Instagram, you know, spread the love of the podcasts that are out there. There's lots of great stuff out there. Which is just another reason why I'm so thankful that you're spending some time with me right now. But after you get done spending some time with me, check out those other ones, because there's lots of great stuff out there. So that's it, you guys. That's my show. That's what I have to share with you today. Keep posted. Definitely subscribe if you haven't already subscribed. Stay tuned. I will be posting a vlog episode in between each of the podcast episodes to kind of keep you updated on my progress towards my goals of 2017, which I talk about in the first episode. They're just really informal. I shoot them with my phone. The last one, I definitely forgot to turn my phone to landscape mode, so some of it is in portrait video, and I apologize about that. I'll be better about it in my next one, but yeah, and have a great weekend, and happy knitting, and I hope to see you guys next time. See you later.